All righty, good afternoon, everybody. It is, according to my computer, 2 p.m., so I will call this meeting, this regular meeting of the Washoe County School District Board of Trustees to order, and we will begin with our roll call. I'm looking over here, I'm so used to that. Madam, oh, right. Mr. Clerk, Mr. Clerk. Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Madam President. Trustee Feimster.
Here.
Trustee Frankel.
Present.
Trustee Simon Holland.
Here.
And then I'm here, Trustee Mayor.
Here.
Trustee Raymond.
Here.
Trustee Taylor.
I'm here.
And student Deutsch. And we have a quorum, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. We will now have our Pledge of Allegiance, and I'm going to ask our friend from our teachers' union, Mr. Chuck Fletcher, to lead us in the pledge. Thank you, Chuck, for volunteering.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Fletcher. We'll begin with public comment. If there is any, JJ, do we have any public comment cards to be?
We do.
Please.
Denise Colton.
Welcome, Ms. Colton. Right there, you have 3 minutes.
Good afternoon. We come to you today to present information that we believe will lead you to decide to keep Brown School on the balanced calendar. I'm Denise Colton, and I've been a teacher at Brown for 26 years. First, a brief background of why my colleagues and I are here today. Our school has faced overcrowding challenges for the past 15 years. In 2007, we triggered multi-track year-round and were on this educationally less effective schedule for 5 years. In 2013, Washoe County School District developed a strategic plan which called for all schools to move to the balanced calendar. Unfortunately, Brown was to remain on the multi-track year-round calendar. Our five-year experience with multi-track had so many pitfalls that negatively impacted our school community that we came to the board to seek what was best for kids, and that was to move to the balanced calendar. Thanks in no small measure to board member John Mayer, the board listened and responded by investing $1.5 million in portables and later a very expensive but wonderful parking lot. In 2014, the board passed a policy that any school that reached 120% capacity set for the building, excluding portables, would trigger a school to move to multi-track the following year. At that time, we were given the opportunity to form an overcrowding committee of parents and staff, of which I was a member. This committee developed our SOMP plan, which allowed us to remain on the balanced calendar for 2 more years. Since that time, we can all cheer that the tax initiative has passed and a new school is slated to open in December of 2018. In addition, a neighborhood charter school, Doral Academy, is in the works and will accommodate about 450 K-6 students. Finally, in the last 2 years, we have lost 4 teacher allocations, which gives us 4 additional classrooms which support either standalone teachers or teachers who want to team. We come to you today to make the case for our school to stay on the balanced calendar. We believe that if we can remain on the balanced calendar, we will be walking on sunshine. Now I would like to pass the microphone to Gina Taylor, who's been my colleague for 26 years.
Thank you, Ms. Colton. Ms. Taylor, you will have 3 new minutes as a new public comment card. JJ, you have a card for Ms. Taylor?
I do.
Okay, thank you so much. Please proceed.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Gina Taylor, and I'm a first grade teacher at Brown. As Denise said, I have taught in the district for 26 years, and I've seen lots of changes with school calendars and changes throughout the years. What I want to talk about today is how we've adjusted at Brown and really have worked hard to make adjustments for a large population. With the school board's help, 5 mobiles, which equate to 10 classrooms, were added to our campus in 2015. This gave us additional rooms to ensure that our class sizes could stay small. The parking lot, as Denise mentioned, is wonderful. It has helped so much with the flow of traffic and safety. It's made a huge difference to families. We even have more space for people to attend school events. Inside the building, we've adjusted. We use our building very efficiently. All the extra spaces we've used for small group instruction, offices. We also, with the SOMP plan, moved our computer lab into the quad. But with fewer allocations, we've been able to move it into an open classroom at this time. As far as lunch goes at Brown, we have 2 grade levels that eat together each day. And during those times, we have empty tables. We have plenty of room for extra classes at each lunch period. Consistency in our cafeteria is also important. We always have a member of our administrative team that's doing duty, so it's maintained good consistency. Brown has a solid academic schedule. We provide Tier 1, 2, and 3 instruction, as well as cohesive grade level specials. Within that structure, recess has been adjusted around those blocks. During our blocks, we have 2 grade levels out on the playground at one time, and they're both in their own designated areas. We also have 2 to 3 staff members that are supervising at that time. We have found that separating recesses as far as grade levels and also designated areas has made a huge difference to promote safety and positive behavior. Our staff has committed to using PBIS and SEL curriculum while working to maintain consistency with our large population. Our school-wide commitment to stay positive and to promote safety and well-being of each child is seen in our hallways and on our playgrounds every day. We would encourage you to come out and see this firsthand. Some of our teachers at Brown, Kinder 1st and 2nd, have chosen to team teach. And we have kids up to 34 children in a class. And we really believe that we have a model of teaching in a highly collaborative and a co-teaching fashion. I have personally taught for 20 years in a team setting, and I think it makes a huge difference. It was really hard to get to all of the children's individual needs, but when you have a team partner, someone's there to look at those individual needs right away. I hope that I have provided you with a little insight on how Brown has adjusted to our population in a very effective manner. At this time, I don't see that we need to make a change in the calendar,
and Mrs. Taylor,
I hope that you will agree.
Okay, I'm sorry to interrupt you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Uh-huh. Chelsea Stibe Brittenham.
Brittenham?
Steve Brittenham. Long and hyphenate.
Steve Brittenham. Yes. Okay. Well, welcome, Mrs. Steve Brittenham.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good afternoon. Thank you for letting us take the time to speak with you today. My name is Chelsea Steve Brittenham, and I have been a teacher in the district for 9 years. 8 of those years have been at Brown Elementary. Our school is the essence of our community. There is nothing more important than a child's education. Our school community was disrupted for 5 years and was crippled due to the multi-track schedule. I was so pleased to learn that the Washoe County School District Board of Education made the decision to support us in moving to the balanced calendar for Brown Elementary School 3 years ago. Our district faces many positive changes through our strategic plan. If we are truly committed to reaching every child by name and face to graduation, then we need to continue keeping all schools on the balanced calendar. I, along with my esteemed colleagues, believe our school's current enrollment will allow us to remain on the balanced calendar until the new school opens in 2018. There is no research that supports multi-track. In fact, the following are reasons to stop, not only based on my own personal observations and experiences, but also the experiences and observations of my fellow teachers and school parents. 1. There are 15 fewer days of instruction. The 15 to 20 minutes of additional time cannot replace those 15 academic days. 2. Classes are unbalanced regarding gender, behavior, special needs, and class size. On a traditional calendar, teachers can decide, as a grade level, the best placement for our students for the following year based on the above-mentioned criteria. On multi-track year-round, students are stuck in a luck-of-the-draw tracking system. 3. Our school community is disconnected. One track is always off when school-wide activities and events are planned, such as back-to-school night, school-wide assemblies, writing night, family math night, PTO meetings, reading week, book fairs, art night, parent volunteer awards, and the list goes on and on. 4. There is no summer for some students, but summer for others due to the luck of the draw. For many fifth graders, their transition to junior high starts only days after they complete their year in elementary school. 5. Our multi-tiered interventions are inconsistent due to students and teachers coming and going. This eliminates the fidelity of any research-based intervention that is now required by the Read by 3 law. 6. There are challenges due to not having enough special education and ELL services for all tracks. 7. There is a lack of time to adequately prepare for a year as our administration, office staff, and teachers end one year and begin the next in 8 or fewer days. There are more, of course, but 7 seems like a lucky number. Due to our SOMP plan and our enrollment projection of what was once 968 students to our current number of 874, keeping us on the balance calendar is what is best for our staff, our community, and most importantly, our students. Their success means everything. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Steve Britton.
Leanne Morgan.
Steve Brittenham. Got it. Yes.
Got it.
I'm sorry, you said Mrs. Morgan? Thank you for a name I can pronounce easily, Mrs. Morgan. Thank you for being here.
My name was a little harder.
good afternoon. Thank you for allowing me to speak to you about the possibly allowing us to remain on the balance calendar at Brown. My name is Leanne Morgan, and I'm a first grade teacher at Brown Elementary. I have taught on many calendars, multi-track calendars, single-track green calendars, and on the balance calendar. And I'm here to tell you how much I love the balance calendar and how it's better for my students. Brown is scheduled to revert back to multi-track calendar next year. Since that decision was made, the citizens voted for WC1, the board is approved an elementary school in the South Meadows, and Brown has lost many allocations. I think we have an opportunity to save the money needed to transition to multi-track and keep our students on the better balance calendar. On the balance calendar, my students are on the same calendar as their siblings. When I have taught on other calendars, this has been very difficult for families to manage their lives. At Brown, we've made many adjustments for our large student population. We are efficiently using every space in our school. We have a beautiful new parking lot that has improved the traffic flow and safety of our students. We have adjusted our recess breaks so that only 2 grade levels are on the playground at any one time. The balance calendar lets our teachers collaborate. We meet often to discuss our students' needs and how to meet those needs. On other calendars, this effective collaboration and sharing of resources does not happen because everyone is at a different place in the curriculum and 25% of the staff is off during every PLC meeting. Most importantly, the balance calendar is best for students. On the multi-track calendar, students miss out. First, they only have 165 days of instruction instead of 180. That is 3 weeks of instruction. We get a few extra minutes a day, but it's not 3 weeks of instruction. The students may be off track for family learning night, school carnival, science fairs, or other school events. Of course, they're welcome to attend, but they're on their break from school and probably vacations. There are traditions that are missed as well. For example, a student that is off track in January will not learn about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Or if they're off in February, they won't learn about Presidents and President's Day. Students' learning builds each day, and the fewer days, the month-long breaks, and the loss of consistency is not what's best for our students. At Brown, our administration and teachers have worked very hard using the SOMP plan to meet the challenges of our large community of students. It is working very well. I invite you to visit our classes, visit our lunchroom, visit our playground, visit our school. We do not need to transition to multi-track with a new school on the horizon. We can continue what is best for our students. Please consider letting us stay on the balance calendar. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mrs. Morgan. We appreciate your time as well.
Angie Woodley.
Welcome, Mrs. Whitley. Right up there. You have 3 minutes, ma'am.
Thank you, board members. My name is Angie Woodley, and I'm a longtime teacher in the district who's been at Brown through the numerous changes. First, we were on traditional calendar, then multi-track year-round, then on to balanced, and now faced with multi-track year-round again. I have experienced firsthand the toll it takes on us as teachers and as a parent. This time, however, it will affect me most as a parent. My son will be a fifth grader at Brown next year. He's gone to Brown since he was 4 years old. He has a learning disability that makes school very difficult. Luckily, he has had amazing teachers, but he comes home exhausted every day, every night, because of the efforts it takes for a child with learning disabilities to get through the school day. Next year, it's a fifth grader on a multi-track year-round schedule. He will not have a summer, but instead 1 week. 1 week to catch his breath before he starts the middle school and the rigor associated with the transition from elementary. This daunting reality would be hard for any fifth grade student to face, let alone one with disabilities. As a parent and a teacher, I feel like this is setting up students to fail, and it doesn't have to be. I understand that there are situations where multi-track year-round is the only solution for overcrowding. This is not one of those situations. Since the previous board decided that we would be going year-round, Brown Elementary's scenario has changed. We've lost four teacher allocations, four less classrooms. Our school population continues to shrink. With the school being built in the immediate future and a charter school opening in South Reno next fall, the expensive transition to year-round is not needed or warranted. Please consider the hardship on students and families. As a teacher in this district, we continually persevere and do what is asked of us. This time, I come to you as a parent and advocate for children. Thanks.
Thank you, Mrs. Woodley.
Kurt Conkey.
Conkey? Conkey. Mr. Conkey? He wasn't able to make it? Okay, thank you.
Nick Colonna.
Colonna?
That's it.
Welcome, Mr. Colonna.
Thank you. Minutes. Madam President, board members, I'm here not to complain. That's strange, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm here to give you money. You like money?
Yeah.
I am a member of the Reno Optimist Club. We were founded in 1940. Been here ever since. And every year we give away scholarships. And we're trying to get cooperation from the Reno School District. Last year we gave away six scholarships, $6,000 each, to people in the seventh and eighth grades. So they're motivated to go through high school because they got a paid way to get to college. We love kids, as you can well imagine. And we do anything we can. And we raise money year-round, hard sweat, tears, to make money. And we're not willing to give it up. But this year, we can't get cooperation. We've got four applications. Four. Last year, we had 24. What do we have to do to give away money? So we're coming to the head. All of you nice people, I know you're busy. We have a hard time trying to get through most of the time. But we're determined to give away scholarships, six, every year. The kids that do this are so dedicated. If you read their applications, you'd want to give them money. They are so well taught. That's our system, right? And we want to see them go forward. We have many people in our club that are very interested in education, and we want to see these kids go forward. And another thing that we do, we have a speech contest every year that starts out at our level at $500. And if they win and keep going, they could win $22,000. That's a lot of money. All we need is names. How do we get middle school cooperation to come to call us? We're inviting you guys to please intercede for us. And we're willing to give away the money. And thank you for your time. We appreciate it much. God bless you all.
Thank you, Mr. Connolly. Yes, sir. Turn your mic on. Turn your mic on, Trustee Mayor. Thank you, sir.
Could we have Kristen meet with him afterwards and try to get help on that? She's right there, Dr. McNeil, and she can help you with that.
Thank you, Trustee Mayor.
John Eppolito.
Mr. Eppolito, welcome, sir. You made it through the snow?
Yes, ma'am. My name is John Eppolito. I'm the president of Protective Added Children. I'm a former K-12 teacher, and I have four kids in the district. Well, one just graduated. I'd like to welcome the new board members. I hope you know what you're in for. I wanted to talk briefly about these free third-party vendors that the school district has invited into our classrooms, vendors like Google, Microsoft, Edmodo, and dozens others. These vendors are paid with student data. That's the reason they're free to the district. I've sent some information to you guys. I don't know if you've read it. The board members that were here before, I don't know if they read it. But there's information in your email. We had several serious questions to the district about these third-party vendors. What kind of data is collected? Why is it collected? Who is it going to be shared with? And most importantly, how will it affect the future of our children? Here's our questions and the district's response, plus these 400 pages that don't answer any of our questions. I don't know why it's so difficult to get answers to our questions. It almost seems like for the attorney it's a joke, but I can assure you for these children, these 64,000 children, it is not a joke. And I don't know if this school board really knows. Hopefully with new members, you guys will look into this. Here's the questions. There's the district's lame response. If you want all 400 pages, let me know and I'll email it to you. It's kind of similar to what's happening with the social and emotional learning. The anonymous donation that the district took a few months ago, according to the attorney, no one on the board, or the board members in general, did not know where the $250,000 anonymous donation came from. That came from CASEL, C-A-S-E-L. They're tied at the hip with AIR. I sent you a video, I don't know if you watched it, but it's an AIR video, and CASEL is one of the main people that speak. It's about an hour and 15 minutes. The issue is not the social and emotional learning. The issue is that AIR and CASEL want the social and emotional data on the children. It's more than test scores. They want to know what makes these kids tick. And from what I've seen so far, it doesn't seem to me that people are concerned enough about this. Research the founder of AIR, his name is John Flanagan. Research eugenics and John Flanagan. These are the people that you guys are inviting into the schools. And I know you guys are new, but this, for whatever reason, this school board doesn't want to address it. 64,000 kids in the district deserve to have your attention, and I'd be glad to meet.
Thank you, Mr.
I'd be glad to meet with one or two or anybody on the board that is interested at your convenience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Eppolito.
You're welcome.
Ronald Lewis.
Mr. Lewis, welcome, sir. You have 3 minutes. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. First, I'd like to say welcome to the new board members. You have a daunting task, and I've got a couple of things I'd like to address that may help you in that regard. Months ago, on a number of occasions, for current and previous board members, I provided a copy of the Comptroller's, State of Nevada, Comptroller's Special Report on Education. It's only a 6-page document, but what it does, it looks at data, policies, and outcomes. I'd really like you to look at that. If you haven't, or it's been misplaced, I'll work with Mr. Kelly to provide additional copies or electronic copies. It's moving data. Many years ago when I worked in the district, when Dr. Morrison was here, one of his greatest concerns, and he would voice this to us, was it's a competitive environment. charter schools, public education, private schools, now looking at additional things at the state level. I'm just going to hit a couple of highlights on what I think is really important on this comptroller's report. And I just stumbled across this when I was at the Nevada Day Parade a few years ago. First, these are my words, not what I'm going to present. There is no correlation between dollars spent and outcomes. I know how to get outcomes. I know how to get performance. Academic, social, behavioral changes, operative conditioning, but there is no correlation. So please look at this. How education dollars are spent is at least as important as how many dollars are spent, but there's no correlation. When you look at 35 countries that were studied, the highest ranking outcome, which I'll say performance, is Korea. They were 25th in their spending. So please look at this and see. It's not policies. It's good educational practice. As you read through this, and I'm really impressed with the Brown teachers, it's that relationship between that child and that teacher. Other thing, national standards. Administrators don't have national standards. I am a licensed school psychologist at the national level. It makes a difference. Why did Brown Elementary School go months without a dedicated school psychologist? How many nationally certified psychologists do you have on staff? How many places are vacant? Why did they go months without? I'll provide this to you later. Thank you very much. I think you're doing a good job. It's a daunting task. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lewis. Thank you for being here.
Wendy Anker.
Welcome, Ms. Anker. You have 3 minutes there. Thank you for being here.
Is this on? It's on. I'm a parent of 2 children in the district, 1 with a disability. I've been here a few times in the past couple of years. The first time was to ask for my children be opted out of the SBAC testing and the NAW testing. That was quite a fight. So it just keeps going on, and now there's the new SEL. I went to a parent university that they came to the school to talk about it. I asked if there was going to be an assessment for this, and yes, they're looking into that. So there's more and more assessments being done, more data collection, but yet our answers are still not being, our questions are still not being answered. Who our children are not being protected, the third parties spreading our information everywhere. I was not even informed of the SBAC, didn't even have a clue what it was about, except for we're not allowed to see the test. The teachers are not allowed to see the test. The principals are not allowed to see the test. Nobody's allowed to see these tests. That's a red flag for anybody. So, of course, I can opt them out. Every year I can opt them out of anything. But then while all those hours, every school year, all those other kids are taking the assessments and mine's not, my kids don't get adequate learning and education because the school district is not required to give those children work assignments. They basically just sit there and read a book. So it's a little frustrating time after time that, you know, our questions are not being answered. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Anker.
Charles Teachout.
Teachout. Thank you for being here, sir. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you for this opportunity to speak.
I'm a former teacher at Washoe County Schools 15 years. Was a teacher in Michigan. And I have some thoughts, particularly with regard to the fact that I was a music education teacher. And that I believe, as heartily as I can state to you, that music, art, and PE are essential to the life of children. I would like to plead with anyone and everyone here in the district that we use some means to attract funds so that we can begin to use these put a lot of time in elementary, middle school, and high school for these subjects. I say that because we have the social and emotional SEL program going. I guess I appreciate the concern about social and emotional learning. And yet, I am in support of what the last two speakers have said, and that is that I think the data that is collected needs to be, we need to know what is being shared. This needs to be fairly, openly, and honestly shared with the public so that we have confidence that our children's data is not being collected by people who are not entitled to that data. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Teachout.
That's all I have.
Thank you, JJ, and thank you to all that gave public comment, and thank you to all of our teachers that took time out to be here. We really appreciate it. Just so you know, and just as you leave, consideration of the school calendar for Brown Elementary School will be on the agenda March 14th.
Thank you very much.
And we won't hear it before 4 o'clock, so you don't have to miss school.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Okay, on to agenda item 1.05. This is an action to adopt the agenda. Agenda items, of course, may be taken out of order if required, but out of order if required by the board or combined or anything like that. Staff is requesting, as a note to my colleagues, staff is requesting to pull agenda items 3.07 and 3.08 is pertaining to the design of the elementary schools and the middle school to tighten up a couple of details in the agenda, in the writing of the agenda. So those will not be considered on today, 3.07 and 3.08. Yes, sir, Trustee Mayor.
It seems like there's three that should be.
Will you please turn your mic on, please, sir? Thank you.
It seems to me as though there should be three of those items grouped together, since they're all about the same architectural designs. So 3.06, 3.07, and 3.08.
You go ahead. Please, sure.
It's my understanding there's an error in the agenda title on 307 and 308, but there is not on 306. And so I think that one is prepared to go.
Okay.
It was an error in the writing of the agenda.
Okay, then I would like to pull 3.06 for discussion.
Okay. So we will do that. But first of all, let's adopt the agenda. Okay, let's do that, and then we can go ahead and pull from the consent.
I move that we adopt the agenda.
Okay. Thank you, Trustee Frankel. Is there a second? Okay. It's moved and seconded that we adopt the agenda as amended. As amended, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? The motion is carried. Let the record show that it is unanimous. We'll have our board reports and superintendent report, and then we can pull items from the consent agenda, colleagues. So we'll begin with board reports, and we will start with our student representative. Start with Ms. Katie, always good to see you.
So last week I had a student advisory board meeting and it was a lot of fun. First we talked about the Joy Prom that UNR's or the one of the clubs for UNR is putting on, the Blue Key Honors Society, I think is what it's called. And I'm really excited for that because it's a really great opportunity for our special needs students in the districts, and I'm very excited to be able to work with them and to be able to attend the event and help host it. So, and then we're also planning the student data symposium, and a ton of students are very interested in facilitating for that event, so I'm very excited for that event as well. It's our third annual one.
Thank you, Madam President. Trustee Frankel.
I'm not going to say a lot because I don't have much voice, but most of my work has been, since I've been sick, I've been home a lot, but I've had many conversations with very active Brown families, parents, and teachers in the last several weeks, much of similar comments to what we heard today. So I've been spending a lot of time responding and interacting with them, and that's what my report is today. Thank you.
Thank you, and glad you're feeling at least well enough to get out and about. Vice President Holland.
There we go. There it is. I attended with Trustee Raymond last week, the AVID presentation at Sparks High, which was wonderful, and also the JROTC presentation at Reed High, which was also exciting, and then today also the student art winners with EDON, and I know you'll be happy to express our appreciation for those students, their teachers, and the parents, and also EDON.
Thank you, Trustee Holland. Jump over to our clerk. Clerk Kelly. There you go.
There we go.
All right.
So I also attended with Katie the Student Advisory Council meeting, and it was really great to see the students talking about different issues. The Joy Prom, for those who don't know, it's a prom that's planned for students with special needs so they can attend and experience a prom. And so anyone that would like to help out, there's information about that. And I just think that Katie did a great job managing that meeting. And then I visited a couple high schools. You know, high schools are like, they're really good community centers. And there's always things happening at the high schools, especially on weekends. And so I visited a couple of our high schools on the last couple Saturdays. And I visited sporting events. There was one at Wooster High School. They were setting up their play for the play coming up. And just really neat stuff going on. So I definitely encourage people to visit the high schools on weekends and see what they've got going on.
Thank you, Trustee Kelly. Trustee Raymond.
So as Katie mentioned, the AVID event on Wednesday, I think the JROTC area management inspection on Thursday, which was great, both events to be in schools and see the students. And then, you know, just on top of that, a lot of continuing to learn and get caught up on everything that I will continue to learn about the district. Yeah, the I know.
You had a Wednesday, Thursday, Friday that happened.
Yeah, there was the Joint Superintendents Association, NASA, and NASB. I'm learning all about my acronyms. So, yeah, lots of learning. It's been great.
That's good training. Thank you, Trustee Raymond. Trustee Mayor.
Turn on my mic before I get my hand slapped. It's been a busy week. We had our two-day annual meeting for the NIIA, and a lot of new changes coming down. Now we have to redistrict or realign the schools and athletics every 2 years instead of every 4 years.
Wow.
And we're looking at creating, as you know, we have classes 1A, 2A, 3A, 4A. We're looking at increasing us to 5A of larger schools, specifically Clark County. So it'll probably just be Clark County and those schools that want to compete with Gorman High School in Clark County. So that's coming down the drain, the pike. And Rollins Stallworth was elected as vice chair. Then I went to the NASB joint meeting of the executive committee and the directors, and I think your appointment of Dr. Feimster is going to fit right in, and our board will approve her appointment shortly, I'm sure. But she did a wonderful job filling in the executive director, I mean in the executive committee. And then I was fortunate to go to the Martin Luther King banquet, which I just get an uplift every time I go to see the ushers and usherettes, the kids. They're so professional, taking you to their seat. It's a highlight. But mostly the highlight is the Air Guard and National Guard have a contest, an essay contest, and to see a little guy couldn't even look over the podium was one of the elementary winners. And if people think that we're not doing a good job educating students, they should have been there that night and heard those four kids, because they were truly remarkable. And then, of course, I also attended many high school athletic contests, even rooting for my Railroaders, who are 0-8 in conference. But I got to see, is our HR director, I got to see her daughter in action, Huckabee for Fernley High School, guard at Fernley High School. So that was kind of a neat treat. And then I was at a service club's invited me to be the guest speaker. And you hear so many negatives when you read the paper or listen to the radio. And these guys and gals were so complimentary of what we're doing for kids, from feeding them, helping with clothing, helping with books, helping in every way possible for these kids. And I want to say that they're very pleased at our new superintendent, because for a while there, the Lions Club was not allowed to do their testing of eyes in the school, and Tracy opened up, with the help of the principal, a school so that they could train and test these kids. And they're all volunteers, club member volunteers. And they tested all the first grade, and they found 18 children that needed further testing because they had real problems and tracking and so forth. And they found 3 of those students needed medical alteration to their eyes. Now, we talk about read by 3. Well, if you can't see, you're not going to read by 3. So I want to thank Tracy Davis for allowing the service clubs, the Lions Club in particular. I was not speaking in front of them, but some of the guys there were telling me about it. And I want to thank Tracy for allowing them to get back into the schools and help children that have eye problems get those corrected. So that's my report. Thank you, Tracy.
You're welcome, John.
Thank you, Trustee Mayor. There you are, you're on. Dr.
Okay.
Kingster.
Thank you, President Taylor. I would just like to make light of exactly what went on at the Abbott program, because it was so wonderful at Sparks High School this past Wednesday. It was great, of course, to see Trustee Katie there, and also Trustee Milena. Last names, I know that's probably better, but I'll get those. It was so important for me to sit with 3 principals and to interact with them, because the principal is the person in each school who truly makes that machine function. That is it. Everyone else helps, but I've got to tell you, when you have a great principal, which all three of these guys were great. Actually, there were four, because the principal from Dilworth was there too. It was absolutely wonderful, and they want to know what we're thinking of them. And I think it's, if we could come up with something like, well, I have a couple of ideas, but they want to hear that they're doing a great job, because sometimes they don't hear it as much. But if we could come up with something, I think that's great. I stuck with the principals. I wanted to hear what was going on. But to talk about the organization at Sparks High School, it was just phenomenal. The kids were so organized. They greeted you. They made us feel as though we were part of the royal family. Well, we are the royal family of Washoe County School District. But it was so beautiful, and the kids were so proud. The best part was at the end, when each one of these kids had the opportunity to share what their goals were, now that they have been a part of Abbott for half a year and some a year, including middle school students. Each student knew exactly where he or she was headed. And it was mostly in the medical field, and that is outstanding to hear that. And their schools, Yale, Harvard, UNR, and schools in California. So to have goals like that and to be so, I mean, they were focused. They know where they're going. And it has a lot to do with the Abbott program, the leadership of the Abbott program, and also the leadership of the principals. And I think it was just absolutely a phenomenal day. And I'd like to thank President Taylor for nominating me for the Executive Committee of the NASB, right? Yes, I was confused. I was at the wrong meeting one, you know, Saturday morning, but it was okay. It was a great meeting, and I'm very happy to be a part of that group. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you. And as we finalize our committee assignments, it'll be the next meeting when we bring it here before the board for your approval. So thanks, everybody's been really busy. I won't be repetitive, just thanks everybody for all that you're doing. Couple of things for in celebration of the Martin Luther King holiday, those of us that attended the dinner, it's always excellent to see our students in some of their finest, and then to see our students get a chance to be awarded for their great work in the classroom. Then also I attended and just kind of represented us that it was an interfaith program in the community on Sunday the 15th, which is actually the birthday of Dr. King. He would have been 88. So that was just nice to have the community come together under that. We had a legislative meeting that Vice President Holland and I attended with our legislators, our state legislators, to talk about, and Lindsay put it together. Thank you, Ms. Anderson, and our superintendent was there, of course, as well as our staff and Dr. Deputy and whatnot, just to talk about our platform and those things that are important as the legislative session goes forward. So it's great to have relationships, meet a couple of new legislators, and just talk about those things that are important, and then answer some questions and address some concerns, and some shared some. And thank you, Dr. McNeil, for getting right on top of those things. It's always good to be responsive. Then later on that evening, we had a reception with those legislators. It was a combined reception with the cities of Reno and Sparks and the county, as well as the Washoe County School District. I don't know if that had been done in the past. It had been done in the past, but it was great to be a part of that, just for all of us together to just kind of touch bases and talk about working together and some things that are important to us as a community. And certainly I was reminded that the PSORN group, the Public Schools Overcrowding and Repair Needs Committee, came out of a broad community effort. And we're certainly the benefactors of that. Represented us at the State of Education address, because that's when you first started getting sick, Trustee Frankel, so we couldn't carpool down. But State of the State address. And it was great to be down there, and we almost had an education section, because TMCC people were around there, and all from everyone from the university as well. But it was good to just to hear the continued commitment of the governor to education in our state. So now we know the real work happens as Lindsay almost moves into Carson City, and I know we'll hear more more from her a little bit later. And just to concur that we really appreciate the continued collaboration and partnership of EDON and EDON Foundation and Mike Kashmirsky and even Willowsea Taxi that got together to do Taxi Top. If you weren't able to be here, there'll be pictures out there and you'll see four tremendous designs that our students did. And when you see them around town, there'll be the taxis that will have some family-oriented things on there that you'd like to see. We can just feel good because our students were a part of that. Again, just another great opportunity, or example, I should say, of our community coming together in support of our schools. This is a really good time to be in this community and be dealing with education. So I know I joined you in just saying we are grateful. Oh, at the State of the State address. DeMonte, it was a small curl group from DeMonte.
Yes.
Oh my goodness, they sang the national anthem, and then there was a little extra time, and the governor, believe it or not, the speaker said, we're ahead of schedule for a change, believe it or not. And so that group got to sing a couple more songs. Oh my goodness, I was so, it was only five of them, and they filled up the chamber, and I mean, I wanted to have a table outside in the lobby with CDs that we could sell. And make some money for them out there. But they just did a tremendous job. It was so great to see our students involved in that. So thank you for whomever arranged that. They did a great job. Please.
I just want to do a shout out to the director, Jennifer Tibben, who's a musical instructor at DeMonte Ranch, and she's had a lot going on personally and was able to continue to do that. And it's a wonderful choir that they put together.
Were you able to watch it? Did you see?
Yes.
They did a great job, didn't they? I was very, very proud. I wanted to stand up and say, our kids. That's public education right there. Our kids, but they did a great job. So thank you for mentioning her. She does a great job. Superintendent Davis.
Thank you. I know we're getting ready to put up a visual, but before we put that visual up, I just want to thank our amazing staff during inclement weather. Man, it's always so hard to just like figure out how you all get this done. And at 3 o'clock in the morning, the text messages are rolling and everybody's up. But making sure our families and our kids are safe and making the right calls. So thank you so much. And really a shout out to our community partners. The county, City of Reno, City of Sparks, just the work that we continue to do together. I have my monthly meetings with Mayor Sheeby, and we just talked about the state of the city and state of it, and it's great to have somebody to have those conversations with. Is the graphic coming? I'm kind of killing time. We ready? Okay, ready. But I'm really thankful for those continued partnerships. As you talked about PSORM, but I think it extends beyond that work as we continue to work as a district. So today I'm really going to talk about the work as we talk about Every Child by Name and Face to Graduation. This year we kicked off a little something different. Every high school student actually received an invitation from the superintendent to their graduation and support. But also as part of that, there were bookmarkers inside of those invitations for our families, so if they need to get counseling services, figure out how to retrieve credits, they didn't have to go online. There's something right there in the thing, put it on the refrigerator, do not go search, like we want to help you out. One of those pieces was our freshman initiative to 20 by 20, because our freshmen this year are our class of 20 by 20. They actually got magnets to their graduations. And also because each class is unique, this year is one of those weird years, so the requirements for each class is a little different. So we wanted to ensure that our families knew what the requirements for graduation are for those kids to graduate, because we all know what happens during graduation where the superintendent's the bad guy and say you can't graduate. But part of that is educating our families about what that is. And for us, it is not about being reactive. It is about being proactive. A few years back, we embarked on as a district the door-by-door initiative, which we like the door-by-door initiative. Unfortunately, door-by-door initiatives tend to be a one and done. And we have to follow kids all the way through. So the department, the deputy, they came up with this amazing, crazy plan. And I thought, okay, I hope this really works. But today was our big kickoff of how we address some of those issues in partnership with the schools. And part of the district's part is to look at our freshmen, right? And look at what happens to our freshmen and do some work. And we go to the high school. For me, it truly was exciting because I spent the last 9 months doing meetings about what we would do with funding, what we wouldn't do with funding, right? So away from kids and the work. Today was back to business about kids and work. and the deputy and the team goes out. So I want to kind of highlight HUG a little bit because this was so amazing. Sorry. I just want to show you my scarf, and we'll talk about these in a second, too. Some of the work, so you kind of have an idea what this looks like for our class of 20 by 20. And our work that we're doing. So usually what happens is the soup and the team goes in, and it's their show. It's not like do X, Y, and Z. Whatever they want to show us about the work they do, because each school is unique in what they offer. So HUG presented us with this. So I just want to talk a little bit about some of these pieces. And for Lauren, it was 1,475 kids by name and face for her, because that's the number in her school. And they did such a great overview of all the things that are happening with their victory funds and the supports that are provided for students. We talked about the AP capstone. Right now, we only have one high school that is a part of this AP capstone, and that's Incline. And we announced that HUG is now actually accepted into this AP capstone. It will start with our gifted and talented students. It will go on to our host of students, but then it will be for every kid that goes through HUG. So this is a really big deal. They were so excited around this work. Then we talked about vision boards. And one of the things that every kid in HUG did was a vision board. And what Lauren talked about and her staff was, the vision boards, as long as you talk about it, it's a dream. But once you write it down on paper, it begins to be a goal. And when we went around the room and looked at all the goals, whether they wanted to be in the military, whether they wanted to be engineers, they were so creative, and down to being, what was my favorite one? Oh, traveling and eating hot Cheetos and the Takis, right? But it was so important to make connections with kids so they understand that you understand where they are. I want to talk a little bit about the social emotional learning, because I think this is a big piece. They had 92% of their freshman class, somebody went and knocked on a door and met with the family, and not just one time. It could have been multiple visits. And I think that's huge to our big initiative, our larger initiative around the parent teacher home visit, because we're making an investment in those students. But when parents don't understand about graduation and the requirements, then we get stuck in their senior year. So how proactive are they about knocking on doors, meeting with families, talking about the supports, which we could be here all night talking about Saturday school she offers, intervention. Just a plethora of things to support students where they are. When we look at the Gate Institute, as you know, this is the one that almost made Lauren cry. I have to tell you, we were all kind of getting misty-eyed. She talked about the Gate Institute, and a week after our incident at HUG is when they kicked off the recruitment to talk about it. And she said, oh my goodness. She goes, I had parents putting me in tears, because when you speak about every child and what was afforded to the gifted children and how HUG is doing an amazing job, there were parents talking about how they wanted their children at HUG. And let me tell you, to me, that is a big deal, because we know what stigmatisms are around HUG High School and what she's doing to change the climate and the culture of that school. So she got teary-eyed, and we were like, okay, let's move on. But like, how amazing is that to meet the HUG students at their need, gifted and talented, and how the parents recognize how important that environment is. Then we talked about the vertical alignment. So not just that we graduate kids when they get to HUG, but what does that look like when they come from trainer and they go to HUG, and we have this transition, and what does that look like for elementary school, and the work that they're doing around our ELL students, some positive data points that I'm not going to get into today, but they're doing some pretty significant things. And when you look at where they were last year at this time with having kids on track to where they are this year, a huge significant growth. And then when we look at our special education initiative, the same thing with those points and talking about how creative they've been with their victory funds. When you look at the slide where there's a little house, because Lauren was talking so much, I'm like, I can't tell all this stuff. But here's what I want to really wrap around, because you know when you do this work as a teacher and as a principal, there's only so many things you can control, right? But what we talked about is what can we control and what opportunities can we afford children? We have children going to Big Bear doing camps. They came in second place in the drill team and a global national recognition where there's teams from all of the countries, and HUG High School came in second place. When you look, yes, that's amazing. They're proud. We talk about the Heritage Music Festival, where they send kids to the jazz festival, and just how enriching that is. So it's not just that we're talking about you got to graduate. What are these other opportunities that you get to explore? And I think they're doing a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. The small picture in the right-hand corner, when we had these snow days, that's a CLS class. And we know, if you know about that work, we like to give those children comprehensive lifestyles, skill. And so those are some of our students with our highest needs as it relates to disabilities, the short piece of it. And so we do a lot of opportunities to get them out on field trips, to engage in the real world. But because of the day, they couldn't get out. And if you know anything about teaching and learning and having a class that says, oh, you're not going to field trip like that, like it gets crazy. But they created this opportunity for them to do some team building out activities and to do make snowmen and talk about community. And it turned into something so amazing for those kids in a day where they could really be off the charts because of the weather and all these other things. Like, those teachers made it truly meaningful for them. So I'll tell you, the last thing is, so when I talk about this scarf, why this scarf is a big deal, part of their positive behavior support interventions is they do HERO, and they get tickets when they are late for class, when you're on time, when you turn in your homework. You can't always control homework in the classroom. Anybody who's done this work, then teachers are upset you're not turning in the homework, right? Kids are late. But what can you do to motivate kids? So they decided to use this HERO system, and I believe it is fantastic. So kids get tickets. You turn in your homework, and so instead of it being a negative experience about relationship, you didn't turn in your homework, it becomes positive when you do, and they earn points. And for kids who can't afford items, they can use their points to buy things like hug scarves, sweatshirts, and things like that, and hats. And so it becomes a positive intervention for kids for a variety of reasons. So when they look at their data, they can show how it's impacting kids being in school more, kids turning in their homework, and how that impacts grades, how that impacts engagement. And so we are doing these at every high school. The second part of it is the superintendent hosts a lunch with those some students that the school identifies that are at risk. And we just talk about the work and talk about what happens when you fall down, how you get back up, and who are the people in this building to support you, how you support each other. So you're not going to miss a credit. And one of the students told a story about failing algebra today. And then she said, but because of the support mechanisms around her, she had an opportunity to make up that work, and she passed the class. So we don't have to wait to her senior year to say, oh, well, your freshman year, you missed algebra. And that's what we're trying to build around all of our students in the district. We will be going to every high school to do this. Also, parents were invited to come. And so our idea is, how do we continue to engage and educate and also listen to the needs of our parents as we move the system forward to increase opportunities for each student to be successful when they walk out of a Washoe County school, high school, to be ready for college or a highly skilled career or military. Sorry that was long, but there I missed probably 50% of what I was supposed to say, but there's some great work happening in our schools, and this is the opportunity for us to go really talk about the work with the students and with the teachers. And Dr. Feemster, as you said, one of the things that Chris and I walked out, we talked about the leader of a building makes a difference. And when you talk about the leadership of that HUG staff, I mean, they were all over us. But you could tell that because they bought into their resiliency, the teacher's resiliency, you could fill it with the kids. And I had a line of kids hugging me and thanking me. And it was really about what they were doing to HUG High School, but just really talking about that work from a big picture. So that's my report.
Awesome report. Great things happening. One of the things that's really good to hear is as we look at 90 by 20, starting this freshman class, because that's the class of 2020. So doing those extra things along the way, I absolutely love the idea that you already invited them to their graduation in 2020. Yes. That's pretty exciting. I hope they have those magnets on the refrigerator and it kind of keeps them going. Yeah. That's outstanding. So thank you to you and the team. Okay, consent agenda items. This is agenda item 3.01. And I know there are some questions already. I will be looking to approve the consent agenda with the, you know, we've already made those changes on the consent agenda. But I know, Trustee Mayor, you had something you wanted to pull up. We'll open the floor now for any item that any trustee might want to pull. I know Trustee Mayor did, as well as Trustee Frankel.
Yeah, I'd like to pull item 3.06.
Okay, we'll pull that for discussion. And Trustee Franco, is the same item you have? Okay. Vice President Holland?
Thank you, Madam President. I have a disclosure to make on item 3.03. I don't think it affects our decision about it, so we don't need to pull it, but I do need to make a disclosure.
Okay.
And then I did have a question on 3.04. Again, don't need to pull it, but just wanted to be able to ask that question before we vote on the consent agenda.
Okay, so why don't we go to your disclosure,
and then we'll
go in order?
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Madam President. I sit on the board of the Nevada Land Trust, which is a private nonprofit corporation, which has a contract with Mr. Ford, one of the principals in 3.03. Mm-hmm. His contract is through the Conservation Fund to assist with a conservation land transaction. I'm just disclosing this commitment in a private capacity to the Land Trust and to Mr. Ford. Neither I nor the Nevada Land Trust receives a benefit from my participation in this agenda item. My commitment in a private capacity to the Nevada Land Trust does not materially affect my participation in this item, as the Nevada Land Trust is receiving no greater benefit from any other member of the community. And with regard to Mr. Ford, his selection was unknown to me, as it was done by staff without my input. His selection does not accrue a benefit to him over any other member of his profession, and as a result, my decision is not materially affected by that commitment. So I do plan on participating and voting in the matter.
Thank you, Vice President Holland. And you want to have a question on
3.04? I did have a question on 3.04. Mm-hmm. I just wanted the staff on the record to clarify where the funds to cover this 60% increase in the contract cost will come from, and then just how this applies to future contracts. And I appreciate they answered the question for me, but I like to get that on the record for the benefit of the public. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Vice President Holland. Mr. Tabika, or please.
President Taylor, members of the board, and Superintendent Davis, for the record, Joe Gabika, interim capital chief facilities officer or something. 3.4 is a change order. It's the second change order you've seen in the last month. We're not proud of these, and we have to bring them forward, to be honest with you. In this particular case, we had the contract to put in the new mobile restrooms at McQueen High School was actually two contracts. One for the utilities work and then one for the building itself. And where this came to play was there was a bust between those two contracts. The utilities contract included no electrical extensions to the mobile. And the mobile original design was natural gas. We have no natural gas to that location either, and it's going to be much more expensive to get natural gas there. So we had a transformer and electrical service to the mobiles. Fairly close to where this mobile restroom building was going, so we had to, after the contract was signed, go for a change order to bring electrical over. We would have much rather have caught that earlier, had it in the design. If it was in the design, it would have been a part of the bid. We would have paid for it regardless. The only difference, the premium the district is out here, to be honest, is the difference between a bid price and a change order price. We still had to get the work done regardless. So that's the reason for the change order. The money will come from contingency funds. In every allocation plan, we put in some contingency funds because in our allocation plans, they're based upon budgets, and budgets are budgets. Sometimes you hit them and sometimes you don't.
Thank you, Mr. Gabika.
Any further questions for Mr. Gabika or Mr. Etchart while they're here on this particular agenda item? Okay, hearing none, then with the exception of agenda item 3.06, which will be pulled for discussion, and those others 3.07 and 3.08 that were removed, I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as changed.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Is there any opposition? Okay, the motion is carried. Let the record show it is unanimous, and we see the appropriate staff members in place for agenda item 3.06. So, Mr. Gabika, I will turn it back over to you.
I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm getting a lot of calls from the public on these three items. And you know, we're transparent now, so everything, they learn about everything and they ask questions. The main question is, if we're taking the plans like for DePoli and making the new middle schools the same, why do we need to have architectural designs and things like that if we can't just take the paper cutter and put it there. And if we could, if you could answer it on the spur of the moment, or if you could make a position paper as to why these funds are needed. I would imagine that the terrain, probably you need some adjustment with the terrain or something like that, but I don't know, and I'm getting an awful lot of calls about that.
There's a number of things that enter into that question and into the answer. First of all, by state law, and I, to the degree that I know, every state in the union has the same law, is that the architect, the designer, owns copyright to the design. The district doesn't own the design. We pay for services for them to design a building for us, but they own the design. That's the first thing you have to understand. Now, that being said, you know, we can reuse the design, and we more often than not do. For example, the what we call the pinwheel elementary schools that we built. We built 23 of those, but it was always with the same firm, okay? We negotiate a much reduced design fee for that, but we still have to pay them a fee to design that building again. And you're right, Trustee Mayor, that much of it has to do with the site. Every site is completely different. And a lot of the costs that we have when we site adapt a building have to do with the site, have to do with the landscaping, have to do with the parking requirements or other requirements, because jurisdictional requirements are different. City of Sparks would have, you know, a little bit different requirements than the other jurisdictions, and you have to go through a slightly different process, although it's much aligned now, to be honest with you. But I asked the very same question with regard to the Napoli design, and I did try my best to answer that, and hopefully you got my answer, but there's a lot of changes between Napoli and now. When we designed Napoli, that was in 2007, it was a different building code. It was a uniform building code at that time. We've now gone to the International Building Code series, so there's a lot of code changes, so that's one thing. Second, and is that we went through an ed spec process, and we updated the ed spec, and there were some changes to the ed spec, so the architect has to deal with those changes. So the floor plan may change slightly, and when the floor plan changes, the mechanical systems change, the reflected ceiling plans change, electrical plans change, everything changes. So if you would bear with me, I can kind of read quickly through the changes between this and Napoli, but there are a significant number of changes between Napoli and the middle schools that we're doing now. So that's one thing. Now on the elementary school, specific to item 3.06, this is a totally new design. We've never designed this elementary school. We started on it back in, I want to say, 2008, 2009, and we were, you know, we had gone through the ed spec process. We had done a design charrette. We had started to pull the plans together, and then the economy basically tanked, and we put the plans in the drawer and just set them aside. We took the money for that elementary school, and we revitalized eight elementary older elementary schools. We also have updated that ed spec, and there's been some significant changes to that ed spec. It's quite different than the ed spec that we had back in 2008. The architect basically is starting over on that design. So on item 3.06, it's a totally new design. For the items that were pulled from the agenda, 3.07 and 3.8, those were middle schools. And again, there's changes there too.
Mr. Gabica, just if I may, if we can just keep this to 3.06,
okay,
since that's the agenda item,
okay,
that'd be best to do it that way. And then those further questions that come up when 3.07 and 3.08 come up, specific to the middle school design, we can get back into that detail if we would. Thank you. Mr. Mayor, I know you had another question, Trustee Mayor, then Trustee Franklin.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The plans that you are talking about, was that for the Lemelson School?
Well, it's not what it is Lemelson School now. It was Lemelson School at that time.
Out at Double Diamond.
That school got moved about three times, you might recall, by the board. At one time, we were supposed to be out in Double Diamond, and then the board moved it out to the Spanish Springs area. And we had that. We had just started that design. We were in just the embryonic phases, doing site work and some soils engineering, some different things that way. when the board decided that we really didn't need that school, our population flatlined, and we didn't go forward with that design. But yes, that was the design I'm talking about.
That's the design that you're doing, tweaking, so to speak.
No, sir, that's the design that's going to be totally new. The elementary school that we're talking about here is a totally new design, but it was the one that we had started on, but we didn't get far enough to really have a full design.
Okay. I'd like very much if you could put this in writing and maybe put it on our web page, because I'm getting a lot of calls on this.
Thank you, Vice President Mayor. Trustee Frankel has a question. I know, Mr. Etchert, you would like to jump in as well. Trustee Frankel.
And actually, I had almost exactly the same questions, because I also was getting questions about it. And I think one of my questions had to do with the process by which we selected the architect. And I think we're going to be seeing, and I totally appreciate the amount of work you're doing under a short amount of time to move these things, these projects forward. And so I know that we're going to be seeing a lot of these, and you all are going to be working really hard, and I truly appreciate that. And I think part of what would be helpful on some of these items, one of the things I'm wondering about is, I mean, I have a specific question on the process of choosing the architect, but my attention usually gets raised when it's an amount at this amount. And I'm wondering about contracts of this size being on the consent agenda. So that's a process comment I'll make at this point. And also to follow up on what Trustee Mayer was saying, if we keep them on consent, can we get additional information that answers some of the questions that you just answered, Mr. Kubica? And thank you for answering them. But I do, one of the things I'm always interested in is who applied for the RFP, what criteria did we use to select them? I know often it's cost, but I always like to hear more about that. And I know there were similar questions asked at the last meeting by Trustee Holland, and I have the same one. So I'm wondering, as a comment to staff as well, if we can get additional information on some of these as part of the agenda packet so that we can get some of those questions, anticipating some of what our questions are going to be, which are usually, you know, who else applied, what were the criteria used to evaluate them, what is the service being provided in a little bit more detail, not extensive detail, because there's so much, and I know that, and we can see a lot of it in the agreement. But I think part that might help with some of these questions, and I know we're all going to have them, and we're going to see a lot of these types of items going forward, including the two that got postponed today. So back to my actual focus question on this item 3.06, about the process that was used, and you're recommending this particular architecture firm, and I'm just curious who else applied in the process of choosing and selecting them.
Well, since that process happened back in the spring of 2008, to be honest with you, I would have to do a little research.
Okay.
RFQs for architect is not cost-based at all. Architectural services it's a request for qualifications. You do it strictly on qualifications. My recollection was pretty much every major firm in town at that time applied, some of which are no longer in business anymore. This particular firm, after, you know, submitting the RFQ, being shortlisted and interviewed, was selected for the work. And as I said, they were very excited about having been selected, and we had just gotten started, and we pulled the rug out from underneath them. So yeah, that they were selected to be the architect of record for the new prototype elementary school, which is what we're still trying to do today. And I will find out who all the architects were. I'll find that board item. I believe it's all in there.
If I may, just to piggyback on that, and this is more to make sure the question is answered publicly and on the record. So what the recommendation here is to go back to the architect that won, if you will, back in 07, 08, because that never got completed. So go back to them and pick it back up, because we've really already made a commitment. Am I?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And not only that, didn't get completed, we didn't even really get started.
Right. Okay. And so it's really picking up the process. We paused
Correct.
In 08 to get back to that
Correct.
And answer for this. But moving forward, the additional information, those questions have come forward. And I believe Vice President Holland has had some conversation with Chief of Staff about, as we go forward, making sure that additional information is there. And we were already down the road for the next couple of meetings, but we will begin to see that as a matter of course, because that's important information. Yes, Mr. Etchert. Thank you, Trustee Frankel.
Pete Utchart, Chief Operating Officer. I'm just going to add a couple things on to Joe's comments. Not only have two code changes happened since the 2008-2009 when this elementary school was started or the other schools, but also we have to remember that a lot of the, even the equipment that's actually used in some of those older schools we built is no longer available. I mean, it's basically taking a set of plans and almost redoing them, you know, bring them up to current codes, current equipment, changes that have happened, any kind of ed spec changes. There's a lot of work. So it's not like starting with a brand new school. But when it's that much time separated, it's almost like doing a brand new school. The other thing is I'd like to add is that, I think Joe provided the board a very detailed answer about, you know, you can go through it all on architectural and structural and mechanical and so forth. I think we'll work with our communications department to see if we can get this posted on our FAQs so that, you know, we can at least point people as you're getting calls and say the answer to that exact question is on the website. I think that's probably a good use. We use that FAQs a lot during, you know, the campaign. I think, you know, now's a good time to keep it. I know that Irene has given a very detailed plan for what they want to do going forward. And then I guess that's really it. Thank you.
Well, thank you for that. Trustee Mayor?
With those answers, I'm satisfied to move for approval of this agenda item.
Okay. Is there a second?
I had a question.
Okay, let's get a second, and then we'll have some discussion. Okay, so don't lose that. It's been moved and seconded, so now for discussion. Dr. Feimster?
Yes.
Just get your touch your button. Get your mic on. There we are. Okay.
Ms. Tukabika, your work is excellent. I've known you for a long time, and I'm very proud of your work throughout the years. But when you mentioned the statement about the architect actually owns the design, and this is not my area, but what comes to my mind is if you're building three elementary schools and we're using the same design, does that mean that we have to pay extra money for each elementary school, or because we're tailoring it to the terrain, as John would say? Or I'm just, and I know we're going to get the information, but just off the top of my head, I just need to know something more.
Yeah, when you would not pay at all the same fee for all three. Typically, you would set up one of them to be more or less the, if you've never designed a building ever, the first one would be your prototype. And you can expect to pay for architectural services for a prototype somewhere in the neighborhood of 8 to 9%. That's traditional. It can go as high as 12% depending upon the building. It can be a little lower depending, again, how big the complex is or what you're doing. But after that, as the owner, we have the right to negotiate that. And we've negotiated that from like 9% down to like 5%. Because the building itself really doesn't change that much. It might have a few changes, but usually very little. For example, in the 23 Pinwheel Elementary Schools that we built, there were actually three generations of those. Between each generation iteration, we did some pretty significant design changes, and we paid a little bit more to integrate those design changes in. And just to deal with the engineering involved with all of that. But for the most part, anytime we did a site adapt, it would be 5%. Because you're right, the only things they're really dealing with at that point are the terrain, the landscape architecture, vehicular and pedestrian access issues, and also where we've done the ground source heat pump systems, where to put the well systems for the heat pumps. So, and the other thing that enters in these days is the seismic code, because back in what I called the old days, when we were building schools rapid fire, we were all one big seismic area. That's not the case anymore. The way the seismic thing is set up now is that, for example, in Washoe County, there are numerous seismic areas. And so a structural engineer has to define exactly where you are and do his seismic analysis for that very particular spot. And that can change pretty significantly. And so those are the kinds of things that change from site to site to site.
Follow-up question. Do we deal with the same seismic person for every site? Or
when we pay for architectural services, bear in mind that we're not just paying for just an architect. Architect has a team of engineers that basically are sub-consultants to him. You have a structural engineer. We call them a mechanical engineer, but they're basically HVAC and plumbing. You have an electrical engineer that deals with power, data, all of those kinds of things. Those guys work for the architect. His job is not only to design the building, but to integrate and coordinate their work to make sure it all works together. When it comes to this, a particular building, I've never seen an architect do it. I suppose it has been done, but typically an architect, if they're doing the very same design, will also work with the same design team. So with regard to the seismic thing, the structural engineer that works for the architect that does the structural analysis would likely be the same on that design as it continues forward, unless there were some sort of a dispute or conflict between the architect and his sub-consultant. Another consultant could pick that up. But they do a seismic analysis for every site. They don't just, it's just, you don't do it for this site and just move it over there.
Right, because
there's
all
a
different.
Lot of liability and a yeah. lot, they're different. So a structural analysis or a seismic analysis has to be done site specific.
Okay. Thank you so much for everything you've done for Washoe County. Thank you. Oh,
thank you, Dr. Feimster. Any further discussion? Okay, hearing none, all those in favor of approving a consent agenda item 3.06, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Is there any opposition? The motion is carried. Let the record show it is unanimous. Thank you, gentlemen, for your work. We know we're going to be seeing a lot of you, and we are glad about it.
And, Madam President, I just want to say this is very exciting, another step on our journey moving forward. So.
Yes, another school. We're going to go on to agenda item number 4.01. This will be for possible action. This is to actually approve our school district legislative platform for the 2017 Nevada State Legislative Session. And this is to include such items as support of whole and stable K-12 funding, providing high-level instruction and supports for all students, providing rigorous and relevant instruction to meet the needs of every child, special education, commitment to local control of school operations and programs supporting the efficient use of capital funds. And again, this is for action. And before us, we see our new favorite staff member. Well, you know, it's biennial. It's biennial. You drop out of favor after like July. It's temporary. It's temporary. Temporary.
I love you all the time, Lindsay.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor and Trustees Lindsay Anderson, Government Affairs, for the record. I hadn't seen that agenda title yet. That is quite comprehensive. Thank you to our legal counsel for that very comprehensive
teamwork
title. Yeah. So I don't want to take up any more time than necessary. I'm back to you today with the final version of our legislative platform. Just this morning, I got kind of the design, so just wanted to reaffirm that the content will be placed into this nice little one-page, two-sided document with our branding on it and a little bit easier to read. So there weren't any substantive changes to the content of this, and so I'm just here for your final approval. As our last meeting before the legislative session started, we talked about the last meeting that if there were any announcements or possible changes from the governor's state of the state, those would be incorporated. Nothing that he said required any substantive change to our platform, which I think is wonderful. Maybe he used our platform as a guiding document in the state of the state. Oh, just in my head, I'm thinking maybe he did. So we look forward to working with the governor and the legislature to accomplish our goals here. So happy to take any feedback from you. We'll go from there.
Trustee Mayor?
Yes, I just want to comment that this weekend we had a report from Jessica, and it sounds to me like it's a real good team that has formed together, and you're coming to great ideas to give to the legislature, and I'm thrilled to death to pass this, so I approve this, move to approve this item.
Okay, it has been moved and seconded. Discussion, I see your light on, Superintendent Davis.
Well, I want to just thank Lindsay. I think we're going to do a lot of work, and we started last week, which was a very interesting SOUPS meeting. But really, it's about children, right? And when I look at some of the stuff on here and we talk about Zoom funds, victory funds, and how that is actually making a significant difference in our schools, because a lot of those funds are used to provide these kids opportunities as we close achievement gaps. So it's going to be a fun time.
Lindsay, you know I love you year round. I just love you extra during this session. That's extra love. Is that in the minutes, JJ? Extra love. Thank you. No, love. Oh, yeah, but it's global. Yes, bold letters. Thank you, Chief Legal Counsel. Any further discussion, Lindsay? I will say thank you for your work. You work tirelessly on this, and you get on the phone, and you maintain those relationships with our legislature, and keep us apprised of things that are going on. And it's got to be quite a tug and a pull on you and your family. So thank you for this commitment you're making over these next few months, in particular.
And a tug and a pull on me. You blocked my calendar out to testify on school-related things. Lindsay is so, so good about making sure our voices are heard, especially for things that impact what I call reality, right? And sometimes there's theory of what it looks like, and then how that funnels down and translate to the classroom. And Lindsay's really, really good about saying, when it gets to this classroom, you got to be there talking about it from the vantage point. It's really not even the SUPS vantage point, right? It's really about how that impacts teachers that deliver the work, because sometimes it doesn't really funnel through, and make sure that that perspective is provided to our legislature. So once again,
okay, we'll call for the vote. All those in favor of approving our legislative platform as presented by our governmental affairs director, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Okay, the motion is carried. Let the record show it is unanimous. Lindsay, thank you very much for your work. God bless you. Yeah, we're going to have just a quick 10-minute break. God bless you. No, that wasn't just for Trustee Raymond. The superintendent's in my ear, too. So 10 minutes, and then we'll come on back. Let's come back at a quarter till on time. On time. On time. Okay, not too far off of a quarter till. Great job. Now we're on agenda item. We're actually on agenda item 6. We've been asked to reorder that. We're going to take agenda item number 6.01. I believe it's because we have guests in our midst. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your patience. This is consideration of adoption of board resolution 17.-002. Excuse me. Directing that notice be given to the Washoe County Debt Management Commission regarding the proposed issuance of up to $200 million in general obligation bonds, additionally secured by pledged revenues, authorization for officers of the Washoe County School District to take other actions necessary to complete the issuance and related matters. This is for possible action. And we have our guest, Jennifer Stern, who is our bond legal counsel from Sherman and Howard. Thank you for being back with us. And Marty Johnson, our favorite financial advisor, J&A Consulting Group. Thank you, Marty. And, of course, our CFO, Tom. The floor is yours, Tom.
President Taylor, Superintendent Davis, members of the board, for the record, I am Tom Sosinski, the Chief Financial Officer for the school district. And I was going to introduce Jennifer and Marty, but President Taylor was so kind to beat me to the punch. So, but for those board members that don't know Jennifer and Marty, they are our long-term bond counsel, help us with debt issuance, and have been, and Marty with on the financial advisor side. So I wanted to have you see the people instead of me just talking about them. And we're very proud of our partnership with them over many years. So if you have any questions as we go through the first issuance of WC1, the ballot question. So I'm here to give you a little bit of an update as well. We understand, just as we've been sitting here, the county did take action on the second reading of the ordinance. And my understanding is that went through successfully today. And there is one more item that they have to do. There's an agreement between the Department of Taxation and the county for the WC1 administration, I guess, if you will. And that is scheduled to occur in February. And that is will be on their agenda to take action on that. We are still on schedule to implement the new sales tax on April 1st. And so we're here today to walk you through the timeline of the issuance of these bonds. And so given that this is a new avenue for us. We've been doing the rollover bonds, as I described to you in our last discussion. Again, the rollover bonds are the property tax bonds that we have that the legislature last session allowed us to do for 10 more years. That's not why we're here today, but we are here for the sales tax WC1 bonds. So with that, JJ was kind enough to put up the timeline so you could see this process. And so we're here on the 24th adopting, hopefully, this DMC resolution. We're scheduled to go to DMC on the 17th. 17th. Trustee Frankel has served on that commission, so we'll be ready to go back with this same team here to go to the DMC to describe our new WC1 bond process with them. Given that this is a sales tax process, there are a couple new elements in the timeline. I thought I'd just quickly point them out, and that is there is a board adopts a resolution of intent, which will be bringing back to you on the 28th of February. There's also a 90-day petition period that's also new to this process that you haven't seen with our rollover bonds, and so I wanted to point that out to you and also point out that the board will then conduct a public hearing on that process, and that's scheduled for the 28th of March. And then we'll do our normal
process. If I may, yes. May I back you up and just ask you to kind of walk us through it so much, because we have four new board members.
Sure.
And I remember, I'm sure I had to ask you to do the same thing, just to kind of
differentiate
the
rollovers
the steps
from the,
yes,
sure.
Yes, please, if you would.
Yes, I will.
Thank you
and
very
so,
much,
And so our rollover bonds were first approved in 2002, so that was give the district permission to issue bonds with the freezing of the property tax rate. So if you looked at your property tax bill, there's two components that are related to the school district. One is 75 cents, which is for our operating purposes, our general fund, and the other is 3885 that is committed to issuance of debt. And so that rollover met its expiration in 2012, and it sat idle for a couple years until the 2015 session, where the session for any district that had rollover available to it, that was renewed for another 10-year period. So for ourselves and Clark County School District and I think a few other districts, right, Marty? And so that rollover mechanism has been a tool that we've used to build new schools and revitalize schools. And so now we have, through the ballot initiative on November 8th, now WC1, the ballot question, an additional source of revenue, which is now sales tax as opposed to property tax, to do the additional building that we are forecasting that we're going to need to do. And I know Pete and Joe have presented information to you on several different occasions to talk about, you know, what projects are coming forward, and the ballot itself was very specific as to what we would be doing with elementary, middle, and high schools. So does that cover it fairly well, President Taylor? Are there any questions I can answer on that?
And just the steps, what happens from here, and why these steps are necessary?
Sure. Typically, when you issue any type of debt, you have to go through a process of us doing a resolution to go to the Debt Management Commission, which is made up of members of most of the jurisdictions, the school district, the county, the city, and there's some other members on there, the general improvement districts, and the public. And so we take that debt issuance to them. We have to be able to demonstrate the ability to pay for that debt. That's their charge. And so we kind of go through a similar presentation like we're doing for you, but specific to the bonds. And we walk them through that process. They typically ask us about some things that really aren't their charge, which is, what are we doing with those projects? But we try to provide that information and give that to them, and we've been very successful with the Debt Management Commission. And then we have to go through a process of putting a preliminary official statement together. We have to do bond ratings, and we typically work with Standard & Poor's and Moody's and let them know about how we're managing our finance. They're most interested in our capital financing, but they're also interested in how we're managing the operating funds of the district. So we get a rating on our bonds. Most recent ratings, we were able to maintain our ratings with Standard & Poor's and Moody's, and we have high quality ratings with them. We're very proud of that. And then we have to bring a resolution back to you. And so all of this stuff is delineated on the timeline. And if you would like, I can go through item by item, but I did want to especially point out the new items to you today. And because this is new, I brought the lawyer with me and I brought the financial advisor, and we can answer any questions. So that's my general presentation, but I'm more than glad to dive more into the details if you would like.
Yes. Trustee Holland, Vice President.
I just wanted to congratulate you, Tom, and the team on the bond rating being maintained. That's
Thank you.
Tough thing to do, and I know it's very stressful waiting for that answer, so congratulations on that. And just very excited with everyone else to be moving forward with this. This is a really wonderful time. I appreciate the transparency and the step-by-step and sharing this with the public. Thanks.
Appreciate that. It's an extremely exciting time for our community. I would very much agree. Thank you.
I also thought it was just important to note for reminders for us and then for our new trustees, is this is just another level of oversight you know, ensuring that we're going to issue the bonds, but then we have the debt management committee that makes sure that we have the ability to repay that. So just another level of making sure that we're spending money that we actually do have, in addition, or will have as this goes into play. And then that we, in addition to that, we're spending the money in ways that were approved for us to spend the money on. So just another level of oversight, and I think that's important as well.
You made me think of one thing. Before we actually issue the bonds, of course, Pete and the team will be meeting with the Capital Funding Protection Committee to bring you the specific projects as we get closer to understanding where the exact needs of the schools are as they go through their EdSpec process. And so obviously you will know what projects we will be building with these bonds. And our intent isn't to issue all $200 million all at once. We'll do it in increments as need be. So, but we'll seek the authorization for the next, I think it's 3 years at this period. Yeah, 3 years from the Debt Management Commission. So we'll have that ability to issue the bonds over that 3 year period in one or two or multiple installments as we see fit. And we want to do it as the money's needed. We don't want to issue it before it's needed, you know, to save the taxpayers some money.
Thank you. Trustee Kelly?
Yes, Madam President, thank you. Tom, I had a quick question about the board public hearing on March 28th. It's at 2 o'clock. For people that can't make that, is there a chance to have a second one that day, like at 6 or 7 p.m.? Or just talk a little bit more about what that means and if it's possible to expand it somehow for more people to attend.
Good question, Trustee Kelly. I think it's just a matter of working with the Chief of Staff and timing this for whatever time period you would like to have that hearing. I don't know that we'd want to do two. I think we'd want to do one, but we can pick the time that's most conducive to what the board desires would be my recommendation, unless Marty and...
So we can look at, like, making sure it's heard after a certain time, so that as many people as want to come and participate in that matter, so it's not at 2 o'clock in the middle of the day.
So I heard 6 o'clock or after four. Or maybe we can work with.
We'll work with the Chief of Staff. Okay, typically, that's done at a board meeting. So that's when we vary the time on that. The 20th is the board meeting time. I think that's where the 2 o'clock came from, because that's when board meetings begin. So I think that's a good point, in case we do have people that want to weigh in on it. Trustee Mayor?
Yes. You no longer can bond for the whole amount and bank it, because I remember way back when I was a youngster, they sold a bond, they put it in, and on the interest on the bonds, they built Dietrichson Elementary School. Well, you can't do that anymore?
Well, we still issue bonds, you know, and there's a requirement that we have an intent to use that. Remind me, Jennifer, how long is this period of time? Is it... Within 3 years. Back in the time when we were earning interest that allowed us to build that school, interest rates were significantly higher than they are today. We're earning more in the 1% or below range. Back then, we were earning 5 and 6%. So significantly different time frame. But we always want to issue bonds with the intent of spending that money within 3 years. So we'll work with Pete and Joe and the team and see what's needed to stay within that 3 year period of time. And if they need all $200 million all up front within a 3 year period of time, we'll certainly look at that and consider it. But you know, it's all contingent on when are the kids coming and when do we need to build a school. So there's a few moving parts with that.
You know, that George Brighton, he used to be proud that he built the school on the interest on the bond. That was his fame to claim, you know.
I had the great pleasure of meeting the late Mr. George Brighton, and very, very wise man. And I'm sure Mr. Brighton would say the same thing. I need much higher interest rates to build a school, but I don't disagree with you. So,
sounds like those were the good old days.
Yeah.
Dr. Fimson, did you have your leaning in just ready? There you are.
I would just like to thank you so much, Tom, for everything you've done for our district. And I would also like to extend that to Mike. I think you guys have been a wonderful team, and you've really kept us together. So thank you so much on behalf of all the past administrators and current administrators. And
well, I didn't all notice the, him back there.
He was trying to. I told him I thought I saw him on America's Most Wanted, but but he's the real person. Thank you so much, you guys. You've done a beautiful job for us.
Thank you, Trustee Feimster. Very much appreciate it.
Thank you, Trustee Feimster. Any further discussion from the board? If not, I will entertain a motion.
I'll move approval. And do I have to read the entire, let's see. I move that the Board of Trustees adopt Board Resolution 17-002 notifying the Washoe County Debt Management Commission of the proposed issuance of up to $200 million in general obligation bonds and authorize officers of the Washoe County School District to take other actions necessary to complete the issuance.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? The motion is carried, and let the record show it is unanimous. $200 million to build schools. Marty and Jennifer, thank you for being here. Thank you for hanging with us while we had no money, and now we have money. It's a whole lot more fun. Thank you so much. So now we'll bounce back to agenda item 5.01. This is our staff presentation to update the Board of Trustees and the public regarding the 2017-18 budget. This is just for information and for discussion. And before us, as mentioned, Mike Shorter, our budget director, and again, Mr. Tom Zasinski, who's our CFO.
Thank you again, Trustee, our President Taylor, Superintendent Davis, members of the board. Again, for the record, Tom Zasinski, Chief Financial Officer, and with me, our outstanding budget director, Mike Shorter. Just want to start out by saying we were very, very encouraged to hear the governor's presentation at the State of the State with regard to the investment in education. I think that's all near and dear to our heart as we continue to support the diversification effort that the governor's made in this region. And we all know that in order to have successful businesses in our community, we have to have a strong K-12 as well as higher education infrastructure. With that said, the next step for us is to get the details of what that budget looks like. So as encouraged as we are, Mike and I need to get our hands wrapped around the details because our general fund continues to be our biggest concern since 2008. We have been working very hard, and the legislature and the governor have provided us tools to help us balance the budget from 2008 forward, and we had some of our own tools to help us budget balance the budget from 2008 forward, but a lot of those tools have gone away. And I've already mentioned in several different settings that we used $28 million of savings to balance our fiscal year 17 budget, the budget that we're currently operating in, and we will not have the ability to replicate those savings in their entirety. So that makes Mike and I very nervous. So that said, that's why in getting the details is going to be very important to us. And that $28 million number is not a fixed number. It can go up, it can go down. Again, that's why those details are very important. Is that funding going more towards categorical and not enough towards our DSA? Again, that's why we got to get those details. So I don't want to belabor the point. What I'd like to do now is turn it over to Mike and have him walk you through our board policy, our timeline for the budget process, because we want to get engaged with you a little bit earlier than normal, given that we are in a legislative year. And with that, I'll turn it over to Mike.
Thank you, Tom. Good afternoon, President Taylor, Superintendent Davis, returning board members, and welcome new board members. Look forward to working with you all. For the record, Mike Shorter, budget director. As Tom said, our goal really is to provide you with a really solid foundation of where we think we are with the budget. Right now, it's really preliminary to determine the extent of that. What we do know is that we are starting with a $28 million use of savings. Basically, those expenditures are carrying forward to the new year, and we don't have a savings account to replicate that and pay for that again. We're looking at things in fiscal year 17 to save to help offset that, but certainly, I don't believe we can do that whole amount. And those of you who were here in December, we also used some more fund balance, about $4 million, to balance the budget because of our enrollment didn't come in as projected. So that's about $32 million we're looking to offset right there. As Tom says, we don't know exactly where we stand with the governor's budget. Certainly things look good, but if you dive into some of the details, for instance, Victory School funding first year goes up $25 million. Well, where does that come from? It comes from decreasing $25 million for 21st century tech grants. That's just an offset. It's not an increase. $15 million for Zoom. $7.5 million of that comes from decreasing teacher incentive fund. So it's not necessarily brand new money. $70 million roughly in marijuana tax fees and funds. That's just replacing money that used to go into the DSA. These are not new funds. So we're trying to get our hands on this and determine what the full extent of all this is, because there's a lot of details outside of that also. But those are just some of the things I'm seeing right now. So it's not solid enough information to say this is where we're at in the budget. Our objective is to probably through a budget workshop show you where we stand. We're meeting with the Department of Education on February 3rd. Hopefully they will have what they call the DSA workbook. That provides the statewide per pupil amount. From there, we can extrapolate what we think we might get. The process this year will hopefully be to take that number, and it goes into the equity allocation formula or the Nevada plan, and it determines each individual school district's unique per pupil amount. That's supposed to be done early in the process this year, so everybody, all the districts can sort of see where they're at. But until we get to that, I've asked for the workbook. They haven't given it to me yet. The K-12 budget will be presented on January 31st to the legislature. It dives into a little bit more detail than what's presented in the governor's executive budget, but it doesn't necessarily say how that impacts us. A lot of the state special appropriation or grants or through an application process or some type of funding formula. Typically, we don't know what our portion of all that is until after the legislative session or after we approve our final budget. But hopefully some of them we will know. There's $10 million more going into special ed. Based on the old formula, they actually said we were receiving too much. So that might just catch us up to where we were. It doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to get increased funding for that. So these are things that are, you know, we can do our best to determine where we're at this budget workshop as a starting point. But certainly there's a lot of activities that are kind of outlined in the budget timeline. We get revenue projections from the Department of Taxation. Legislature can meet and change things as we go. You as a board, based on hopefully good information that we'll be providing you, can make decisions regarding our budget. So we want to get to that point and present to you where we are, what we're doing about it, how we can balance our budget to best meet all the needs of our students with your input. So be happy to answer any questions you might have.
So I'll just add in before you guys go into discussion. Thank you guys for the work. It's interesting to work with these two gentlemen as the deputy versus the superintendent. It looks a lot different. Only because as a deputy, you want to keep all the money you had, right? But as a soup, you got to balance a budget. But we are hopeful that we get supported. And, you know, all the things I was going to talk about as it relates to funding the base, the DSA versus categorical, and how that impacts us. This whole waiting game is kind of stressful for us as we bring things to you, as we look at initiatives like what do we have to cut on and this process. So know that these two gentlemen are very thoughtful and deliberate as they go down to Carson City all the time. Tom is like texting me 24/7. But it is a process, and we learn through the process. And it is my hope at the end that, you know, we do fund the base, because that's a big, big deal for us and our students and the work that we do. But it's a waiting game.
So if I could just jump in real quickly, I just want to, we didn't dive deeply into the timeline, but the timeline is in front of you. But our primary goal is to try and speed up the budget workshop, which typically has been in March. So we'll, again, a lot of it's contingent on us getting some information, but we're shooting for end of February, beginning of March. So we wanted to at least highlight that for you. So.
And can I just add, as part of that, there had been previous discussion around lining up like department reports before you get to the strategic plan and the, but like, how do we line all this up? And so we're trying to shove some dates real, I mean, it is what it is, like get some of these department reports out so you understand the work and the initiatives that you're new to before we line up with the strategic plan, and looking at how we revisit what we formerly done with the budget so that we're more in line. So that is part of the thought process, and we are going to come back to some
some dates around how do we put this information in front of you so it was not on deaf ears when that was discussed. It was really scrunching a calendar around spring break, unfortunately, 2 weeks out, and how we can get everybody in here to have this discussion. So there is going to be a proposal to do department reports in advance as we work with the strategic plan, as we work with the budget to align it.
Yeah, that was a meeting you weren't at earlier today, Tom.
Oh. Yeah. See what happens. Garth.
Further discussion. I mean, it's clearly a lot of work to do around the budget as we anticipate what we don't even know to anticipate, frankly, but we do know we're a little more behind than we'd like to be. Yes, Vice President Holland.
Just wanted to ask how we're doing so far this year. How are things going? And do we get regular financial reports at this board? I don't know how that works.
Good question, Trustee Holland. So the answer is yes, you do get quarterly financial reports that come to you on a quarterly basis, and they're just something that we're required to do by law anyway, and so they're always provided to the board in your regular board packets that the deputy superintendent facilitates for you. If there's questions associated with that, obviously we're always available to answer questions. In addition to that, you get updates on our investment portfolio. You also get an update on our Nutrition Service Enterprise Fund, and you also get an update on our health insurance internal service fund. So yes, we do provide that information. Your second question was, how are we doing this year? Midway through the year, we're somewhere where we expect to be. Mike just did the augmented budget in December and told you what we had to do to adjust for the enrollment that didn't come through. We trued up the budget to for fund balances that we got in our end of the year audit. And I would say expense-wise, we're about where we expect to be. But we're, as part of getting ready for 18 and not knowing what things look like, we're looking for opportunities to save some funds where we can. And we're working on the plans of those as we speak. And we'll be bringing that back to you to give you an update on that.
So. And can I just add, that comes through the chief of staff. The deputy's eyes got really big.
Did I say that?
Easy.
Yeah. I meant to say chief of staff.
Yeah, thank you.
Good.
Yes,
sorry
Trustee
to alarm
Mayor.
You there.
Trustee Mayor?
Yes.
You just turned your, it was on, now you just turned it off.
One of these days. The meetings that you have down here, you only have one town hall meeting for the budget. You're cutting out those other ones that we used to have?
In the last two fiscal years, Trustee Mayor, we've done, I think, one town hall meeting a year. We're always ready and able to do more, but unfortunately, the turnout at those town halls has been fairly sparse. So we're always willing to do more as needed, and given that we are in a legislative year, if there are opportunities or a need to do more, this is not a static document, so it's a tentative document, so we can certainly update and insert some additional town halls if that's what the board and Superintendent Davis request.
I would think that we would at least schedule two with a little distance between them, because it's a good time to get action by people to lobby for more money or whatever happens at that meeting. They can take volunteers for committees and stuff like that. That's why I think you really need two, because you can get your plans together for, you know, friends of education and stuff like that could hear the facts and say, hey, we need to mobilize, and they could have a table out there to mobilize. So I think you can always cancel it, but it's harder to put it on as you're going and get a turnout, you know.
Trustee Mayor, no disagreement from me. I think that's not a problem, but I'll let Trustee Superintendent Davis join in.
And so Irene can help me out just a little bit. We looked at historical data around these meetings, and we tried to do them in opposite sides of the town at times when people were off. And unfortunately, as much as we advertise, send out Connect Ed calls, because our goal is to get our families involved in this, unfortunately, 65,000 students, and usually we had two people at one, right? like we actually looked at the data. So we tried to do one big one at Wooster, so it was central, like tons and tons and tons and tons of sending messages out with our community leaders. And unfortunately, we always seem to come up short. And so we think of ideas of how to engage people in this process, especially our families. And historically, what we know is if we talk about cutting sports, there's some big ticket items that we know we get tons of people to show up for, right? And then when we don't have those huge ticket items, if you start talking about cutting transportations, right, they come in the droves. But otherwise, based on our research and our data, we would, like, we've been averaging 3 people, unfortunately. And not that we don't advertise, it's the truth. And most of you show up at those meetings with me, too. So it's not like you're not there and we don't send it out. And how do we engage the committee, the community, and more of this process, because we want them to be a part of it, but also, you know, we realize the staff time and effort, and how do we get a bang for our buck to get the most information and feedback from the people we serve.
So, for the record, Irene Payne, Chief Communications and Community Engagement Officer. To be honest, there's not much more I can add to what the superintendent has just said. Over the last 5 years, we have tried everything that I can think of. We've tried changing the time, the days, presenting, having town halls at weekends, having them in community centers, having them different ends of town, one big one in the central part of town, and unfailingly, we do not get people to attend. The budget, sorry, Tom and Mike, so please forgive me, is not terribly sexy unless we're actually cutting something. So if it is impacting people in terms of athletics or transportation, like the superintendent said, then really that does galvanize people to attend and to participate. But, you know, we have tried everything that we can think of. So if anybody has any ideas, we're absolutely all ears to that.
Yes, Trustee Mayor.
You know, I think we ought to put at least 2 down there, because if you remember correctly, and I don't dispute your figures, I leave that up to Trump. But the whole thing is that when we weren't successful in getting money, we had AB 46 came forward, and we had a couple town hall meeting budgets, and we got people out, and the Friends of Education was formed then, and they started with they dumped baskets full of telegraphs and what have you on the legislator's desk. I know Bernie Anderson got about 5,000 of them on his desk at that time. And I think if you don't have it down, then it's harder to get people there. But if you have it down, and you can always cancel it, because you may need to go into action, because you don't know what's coming. And I think it's better to have it there and cancel it other than not have it. That's my opinion, and I don't like meetings any more than the rest of you. But I think sometimes you need to have.
Well, one of the things that we do want to do, I've been just cautioned by Chief Legal that isn't part of the agenda item that we have before us now. It's really the discussion about the budget, and not necessarily how that budget will be presented or shared with the community. Am I correct?
My concern was just simply we're starting to have members chime in and acquiesce and agree, and that basically would be an informal action. I don't want that to happen. I know it's part of the timeline on the agenda, but it's not an action item, so we just need to be careful to stay away from that.
To make sure we don't make a decision as to what kind of thing will happen.
Exactly.
So certainly sharing comments certainly that's appropriate, but not making a decision at this time because it isn't down for an action item.
Exactly.
Any further comments, or did I go ahead, Trustee Mayor, Trustee Kelly?
Another thing I need to know, and I don't see it on here, but if a member of the trustees feels that there's a special need for something in the schools, when do they have to have their request in?
So, Trustee Mayor, for I think what we would do is during the budget workshop, we would go through the entire budget process, and we would then look at opportunities for things that we maybe were missing that we could entertain those types of recommendations. I think that's been somewhat our protocol in prior years, is to use the workshop as an opportunity to go through that type of stuff.
And that's which.
That's the one that says to be determined, the budget workshop at the end of.
The big one there after February 20th.
Yes.
Okay, good. Trustee Mayor?
Yeah, I'm good. Just so I know when it is.
Oh, okay. Trustee Kelly and then Vice President Holland.
Thank you, Madam President. I think from a communication standpoint, I mean, it's always great to have people come to these meetings or these budget town halls in person, but I'd also like to tell the citizens that if they can't make it, or if maybe they're hesitant or embarrassed or afraid to get up and speak, that they can also submit written comments on the budget. I mean, I've read some great emails and letters from people that really detail and describe their thoughts on what's important to them, what they'd like to see added or cut in the budget. And maybe that's something that we can try to do, so that if we only get a handful of people that come in person, but gosh, we get 20 emails and 15 letters, and that to me is just as impactful. And that's something that I would like to see, you know, try to put out to the citizens as well.
So we do that, right? I just want to be clear. I know we have a mechanism of collecting data, so I just want to clarify.
For the record, Irene Payne, yes, we do that. So when we enter into the communications around the budget, there is, when we do the town hall meeting, we make sure that there are cards for people to fill in. Like you say, Trustee Kelly, some people are very intimidated standing up and asking a question. So we make sure that people have the opportunity to write a question on a card, and then we answer it on the website. And we also use that. We have an actual, like an email where you submit a question, and then the question goes on the website and we answer it. And we've been doing that with our capital communications as well. So we always try to have that mechanism in place where folks can ask a question, and then we ask it publicly, and then we answer it publicly on the website.
Thank you, Ms. Payne. Again, this is discussion. We are making decisions here now. Vice President Holland.
Thank you, Madam President. Tom, what's the timing of our employee negotiated agreements? Do they overlap next year and that's already settled, or what's the timing there?
Trustee Holland, with regard to our bargaining groups, we are settled with all bargaining groups with the exception of our professional technical group.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think the teachers are settled through 2018.
4 years.
We have a 4-year contract with them. Through 19 with them. I think we have multi-year contracts with everybody, but the ProTech group is still out at this point in time. So they go into 18 and or 19. So we're in pretty good shape when it comes to labor contracts. In fact, we're in very good shape. So.
Thank you, Mr. Szczesinski. Any other discussion from my colleagues from the table? Okay, gentlemen, thank you very much, and we look forward to the budget workshop that's upcoming and moving forward, and hopefully we'll get good news coming from Carson City.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now on to agenda item 7.01, public comment. And I think we had a public comment card that just came in.
John Eppolito.
Welcome back, Mr. Eppolito. We're 2 minutes later, we would have adjourned.
You would have been disappointed if I didn't get to speak one more time.
I would have sat right here and waited for you, John.
Yes, ma'am. John Eppolito. I wanted to mention, especially to the new board members, AIR, American Institute for Research. I briefly mentioned them before. You guys have invited them into the school now with CASEL via the social and emotional learning. And the other thing AIR is very involved in is the SBAT test. So AIR, not all, and you guys don't have a lot of control over that. I understand that. So AIR gets the raw SBAC data way more than we'll get, the school district, the teachers, or the parents, because they're the ones who administer the test. So not only do they get the raw SBAC data, now they want the social and emotional data. So I would really encourage you people to please find out what AIR wants all this data for. I'll send you the links again. I'll send you like a 1-hour video where AIR and CASEL are talking about assessing the social and emotional learning.
and I'll make it easy for you. I'll send you the links, the history of AIR and what they're really about. It's a psychological, I don't even know how to say it. If I had a little more time, I would have pulled it up on the computer, but I'll send you the links. Please find out what this group is up to and why do you want them in our schools? Because I don't want them within 100 miles of my kids, and I suspect many parents would feel the same way. Which gets me back to something that we've talked about before. What responsibility does the school district have in educating parents? Because I'll send you guys the information. You'll have it. The big question is, what are you going to do with it? So far, what's been happening is nothing. Parents don't learn any of this data, any of this information, unless they're at this meeting, unless somebody talks to them. What responsibility do you guys have to educate parents? And I think you have responsibility. So far, I don't think it's been happening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Eppolito. JJ, any other public comment cards? All right, seeing none, then our next meeting is February 14th here at 2 p.m. We do realize that's Valentine's Day, so it will be tight for those that have things to do that evening. Otherwise, our meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everybody.